from around your children. What are the difficulties you've encountered, and what are the variables that you take into account?
See, I didn't mention something here. I was just discussing with Dr. Brajbhushan about using the resting state fMRI, which I didn't touch actually here. Now, this question became relevant because you'll surprise, the guy who discovered resting state was an Indian, Bharat Biswal, and that was his PhD topic. And he just will do the paradigm without doing any paradigm, just do take on off like that. And it was primarily designed because children, it's difficult to train them to, especially doing difficult paradigms. Motor they may do, senses they may do, language they may still do, but getting into memory and getting into emotion, getting into other paradigm, it is pain, no, they don't cooperate with you. And when it comes to smaller children, like children who need sedation to be in the machine, how do you do this? So that is where the new methodology, what is called the functional connectivity MRI or resting state MRI, became available about 7-8 years back. We have a large data available with our test BGI. I think we have not yet touched it because we are busy with so many things which we are having, you know, beside our clinical responsibilities. But this is one area which can really take care of your needs. You don't have to design paradigms actually. You can look at your domain, what you are expecting, and you can do a connectivity based on domains. Surface connectivity, functional connectivity, and connecting with the DTI. Tectography, that has become the new thing. The last 2 years, a number of people have come connecting the DTI with the network connectivity. So that is what has become very, very important today. And I think we need to work on our data as to go back. I think next month onward, I will start working on the data also. We have a huge data lying with us because every patient who was going to the machine, we are doing the resting state as a routine and in research subjects. So we have a huge data on cerebral palsy, V12 especially, we have data available on them. And we have done a lot of work on this and we have looked into this. So children is a difficult proposition to work with. They have to understand what you are doing, and the best way to do is to do a resting state with them. And I always, that's the only way to do that. The reason is, I always believe that you are not training them with anything and you are getting your domains from the connectivity, which is a natural connectivity of the brain. Even in, like, there are example people in like deep coma. In a deep coma, if you look at the, I have got data from the brain dead patient actually. I have not looked at the data, you know. I have three patients who are brain dead or near brain dead, where I have got a functional connectivity data, you know. The all connectivity just slow down or just disappears. That's a proof of concept actually. We have not yet published it actually. We have not even looked at the data.
But it is a fantastic data that you have.
No, I would, that's what I'm saying. We have a huge boss. Dr. Lauder didn't have much time and he was busy. We are busy with other things, but we have to look at the data actually, you know. In the next, if you are interested, I can give you the data, look at this with Dr. Lauder actually. And that's a huge strength we have with us. Dead brain data, you know, we have. And there's a confirmation of death by no flow in the brain, you know, and there are ways to confirm that. And the guy was dead actually. So you can actually see how the comatose patient, we have got comatose patient data also. Grade 3, grade 2, grade 1, grade 4. So you can see how the arousal, brain arousal, you know, that's important, affects the connectivity. So I'm sure if you are interested, we can give you the data to look at, and let Dr. Lauder spend some time with it, and maybe Vashwati could set up some of the things which we have done, and then you could move from there. See, unfortunately, my data which we have, I'm not able to look at all the data because the clinical responsibilities are so many. You know that most of the time we are working on the patient, and whatever time we get, we look at the science. You know, that's where I have a problem.
About what is called no lie fMRI. So saying that using fMRI we can actually detect whether a person is dying or not. Can you just throw some light on that?
You see, I always believe that you cannot force the brain to think what you want to think, right? Whatever paradigm you generate. And paradigm you are training the guy, you know, to think those things, to do those things. That's why the resting state became the reality, you know. You are not training for anything, you are not doing anything, you are looking at the domains and checking how they are coming. So I'm not sure it is really true, whatever. You may still be told to do X paradigm, you start thinking of Y paradigm in the machine. I mean, there's no control on that. And even when you are lying quiet, resting state, we call it. See, another interesting thing I'll tell you about the fMRI is that when I was doing the resting state or otherwise, like the motor function and all, a lot of activity coming in the occipital brain. Because the eyes, you are seeing through the eyes, you see a lot of activity in the occipital brain. Even in the resting state, if you close the eyes and open the eyes, there is a difference in the connectivity. So whether you like it or not, you see things yourself, you do it what you are doing, and that will anyway reflect into the brain. The brain is functioning, right? What are you doing? So I'm not sure whatever being published is all truth, you know, and you have to be taking it as a pinch of salt.
Another question that I have is, how do you use fMRI for naturalistic models? For example, where people actually have to be exposed to real situations. For example, say driving or while piloting aircraft or something. If we do want to understand the neural basis behind the situation,
yeah, that's a good question because I happen to know somebody who was working on how to find out somebody is accident prone or not. You know, it. In context with hepatic encephalopathy, a lot of patients have got liver dysfunction, they have a dysfunction in the brain, cognition defect. And the biggest problem with them is how to ensure they are safe drivers or not. So they designed a paradigm in which the guy actually sits on the, apparent on the make-believe or virtual, car and start driving the car. So you can create a virtual situations, like a pilot driving the aircraft or suddenly some dog comes and he likes, like you must be seeing if you go to in Los Angeles Universal Studio and look at the 3D thing, you actually feel you are going to hit somebody, And I was scared actually. So you can create some simulators by which you can actually create situations on the console. And that is possible within the machine. Otherwise, machine cannot go in the sky to do the something, So best way to create a paradigm. And that I learned from that guy, who is very small, he's an Indian guy in Mayo Clinic, who developed a methodology to find out that how you can be accident prone and why not. Or just simulations. Or virtual methods of doing things.
So, is there any technique available, for example, if we leave out fMRI, where we don't have to use these virtual systems and the person is actually put into the real situations and we can still get to know the brain areas behind it or the underlying neural connections?
See, I told you in the beginning there are three methods. One is the imaging method, hemodynamic method, the second one is the nerve stimulation method. You can do an electroencephalography, EEG. You can take a small MEGs and check that. That's the only way you can look at the function of the brain is outside the. Otherwise, you need a magnet, you need the whole set of things to see the hemodynamic change. It does not have a resolution, a special resolution, but it has a very excellent temporal resolution. So, I think that is one of the ways. People have done that actually. It's not something new. People have done all kind of situations where they can put in electrodes and check for the brain activity during that. Like you must be knowing that lie detector and other things that they use. So they use all this MEG, EEG, all kind of heart rate, this and all physiology they are using to check those things. That you can do anywhere. For that you don't need a very high infrastructure. But for this kind of methodology, you need a hardware which cannot go to the real situation actually.
Within that, they don't explain the actual underlying structures as the fMRI can
do. No, that's what I'm saying. this is like making believe, and that's real believing it. I always believe that once you train a guy, that's why I say, see, when I do imaging of the brain, I see the actual brain. Whether you train him or not, the brain is brain, right? I can see the structure. The tracks of the brain, I can see the tracks of the brain myself. You don't change the tracks of the brain, you are doing it. The same way, when the guy is lying quietly inside the machine, whatever he's thinking, we don't know what he's thinking. That gets reflected into the network, you know. So that is why I call it, this is called an objective assessment of the brain. And this is a subjective assessment of the brain, I call it. And whatever, see, even I'm talking to you, you may not be listening to me. You may be somewhere else. So everybody has attention span, right? It varies from X to Y timing, but it is something which is not really, you know, constant. So many times when I'm talking to somebody, suddenly my brain goes somewhere. He thinks I'm listening to him and I'm somewhere else. So this thing happens all the time with all of us. So to say that you are attentive to what I'm saying, how I guarantee that what I'm saying to do, you're doing that. Think of a woman, think of a kite, think of something, you know, of a god, think of a devil. So it depends on what you think, you know. But actual thinking, I don't know what the actual thinking is. So that's the biggest issue with the fMRI actually. The real application of the paradigms. And then I told you about getting used to a paradigm, familiarizing with the paradigm, you know. That becomes another issue with that. That's why, in a very big way, the resting state is becoming a very, very popular method today. I think in the last 5 years, if you read the paper on resting state of Hawaii, there are a huge number of people who are resting state. Because it has no objectivity, no subjectivity, all objectivity. How you analyze the data, that becomes, now the analytical tools become like Professor Arthur will give or somebody else will give. That is becomes the most important part. There is subjectivity. So that's the way one has to move in the functional MRI. Improvement resolution and improvement is learning connectivity. In fact, there is a big grant which is being run in US, and a lot of money has been pumped in by Obama. It's the Connectome project. And the Connectome project is nothing but connecting the function and wires in the brain. Functional structural connectivity. And this is all this resting state and this cue ball imaging or DSI, they are the one which is getting, and the FC. Not the bold fMRI, FC fMRI. That's becoming important. We started working on 4 years back on fCMRI, but we never published anything. We never did anything. Very exciting area, you know, fCMRI, because there is no involvement of the patient. Like you do imaging and see images, the same way you see the function and see how they are connected to the wires, like fibers, white matter fibers. Right? And with the DSI, you can go into the subcortical fibers. The resolution is so high, diffusion spectrum imaging, DSI.
I wanted to ask you something. You made a statement that when you take a subject and put him or her into a simulator, basically there is a great degree of habituation effect. Okay, something that usually in behavioral studies one would like to get rid of. Psychologists would like to have unconditioned, unhabituated type of a response, considering that fine, this is a true response. But in the real medical practice, you would have patients whom you cannot ask to, you know, undergo a habituation phenomena in the simulator. So can one construe it that if you have certain type of psychological functions, cognitive functions, which are derived out of patient population research, that would be much more objective compared to where you have the normal participants who are sent to simulators and then introduced to MRA.
I totally agree with you on this, because like I give you an example. If I perform the same test as a volunteer two times or three times, I know what I'm doing. Now, it is a teaching in psychology, I think you know more about that, I know about that, that never perform the same test again for a week. At least let them forget what they did, like jigsaw puzzle or for a small child. Children, they are very smart. They'll quickly pick up. Once they pick up, then they can tell you without you telling them anything, So that's a big problem with all of us, when we see the timing, and try to give different kind of puzzles to of the same paradigm, so that they don't have the repetition of things, There are other methods using the number connection test or the figure connection test. So once somebody knows 1, 2, 3 for how they play, he does it that quickly and finishes, connect the whole thing. But first timer, what it does, especially in disease, is a real life situation. And we do it every day, we do it like a lot. But once you give one person 3 times, the same person who is diseased, he will do better next time, I'm telling you this. We all do that, and once you understand, once you know the way how to come to the room, first time I will take 5 minutes, second time 3 minutes, and next time 2 minutes I will be there. It is what is called a habituation effect, a learning effect, or whatever, is there. That is there. So same thing happens in, that's why I stress on this resting state. And look at your own domains inside the resting state. That is more meaningful than actually doing the true world meaning. That is old now, nobody is, people looking into different things now, because there are no limitations, And to know a limitation about a technique is more important than knowing the usefulness of the technique. So that makes you more alert about what is. Otherwise, you keep writing the crap, the same crap again and again, which is not good for the science.
Also, in terms of, with respect to that pain sensitivity, the physiologically derived pain versus the emotional appraisal of the pain. There are, in all religious practices, you have certain type of belief-based practice which forces you to inflict pain on yourself. Religious community.
Moharram.
Moharram, for example. In Hindu,
they're walking on fire. Walking on fire. I mean, I see them every day, on the TV, something is coming.
I was looking at television episode where the person had multiple cuts, it was knife cut, throughout his body. It was profusely bleeding, but then because somebody had convinced him that this is what, this is how with every cut your sins are also being removed. Okay, so with multiple cuts the man still was without sign of pain.
So I give you a simple example, a guy who comes from the village, his tolerance to pain, because he is used to some pain. And the second thing, he is told in the brain, like the same person when he runs on a fire for religious purpose, and he runs in a normal circuit, there is a difference, because he is conditioned. The brain is conditioned that this is important for you, this is good for you, I must do it. And the same in a normal circuit, you will not do it. So the brain conditioning has a lot of effect on the functionality of the brain also. So that is why I always try to see an unconditioned brain, don't condition the brain, so that's the way you look at it.
There is also an interesting, in the whole set of neuropsychological test batteries, there happens to be a fantastic test in terms of capturing the overall cognitive state of an individual. In terms of how X type of a cognitive function is being performed. I was once just going through the details of how this test actually got evolved. And the best part of it was that there were a set of items, usually the way psychological tests are designed. But then for all of them, MRI was done. Okay. Usually the standard way, the way psychologists would use it, that you have a set of performance activities and then you run factor analysis, and then on the based of the eigenvalue and the factor load, cross load, you drop the items. This is the standard way the tests are being evolved. It was a fantastic way where it was not basically the statistical properties, but it was rather the magnetic resonance in it. And many items got deleted, many things had to be evolved. And I read in the historical incidents, you know, how it finally the final version came forward with multiple revisions. That it was primarily the outcome of the MRI which decided whether a particular item should be retained in the test or not.
That's more objective.
More objective. And that's the reason why in many clinics where they have psychologists in the neurosurgery departments.
Sure.
Okay, they use this very test because they know that fine, this is a well-validated test, so there's no need for MRI right now to be performed. You just have a few selective tests, you see the outcome and you know that fine, this is how the thing is working. Before surgery, of course, you will have the scanning done.
No, good thing happened to psychology is that MRI objectivized the whole thing. That I will say, with all the limitations I have talked about, I am not trying to criticize too much of the technology also. But technology is still evolving. One has to evolve with technology. You cannot be at the same pedestrian, you know. You have to move forward, you know, with what we are getting. So that is what we have to do actually. I cannot still do a bold when I have got a resting state. The correct term is a connecting function and structure, wiring correct functions. You know. You have the functioning brain, but there's a roadblock. It doesn't function, right? Then the guy wants to find some alternative routes of coming. You know, we call it a accessory area or a secondary area in the brain or tertiary area in the brain to function or something like that. It comes, you know, they all come because of this thing only. You know, and I think this is going to be the future of connectum is going to be the future for understanding brain function. In fact, I am planning to write a grant where I will involve Dr. Raptor also. If you can put that grant, especially in B12 context, which I will talk tomorrow, you know, which is interesting, very interesting to my mind. And then we can connect the real, you know, structure and function to understand why it is happening.
Sir, I have a question. When we're talking about clinical population, let us say we have others who have some kind of intellectual disability, let's say mental retardation or any kind of developmental disability, let us say autism. Suppose, you know, you're interested in a particular paradigm, let us say the paradigm is to see how they match. It's a matching task, right? So is it a good idea to take individuals who can and who cannot match and who have the same disability, is it a good idea to compare with the disability?
No, sure, yeah.
Or take one group that has the disability and compare it with the normals. Individuals, let us say, with autism or mental retardation, obviously the brain is compromised in some way or the other, right? And within that, you have high functioning and low functioning. Okay, one group is able to perform, the other group is not able to perform. So when you are trying to compare, is it a good idea to compare between the disability group or take children who have, let's say, mental retardation, autism, and see how they perform in relation to children who are normal? So which is a better paradigm?
See, it's a question of what kind of population you are handling. If your power analysis tells you have the numbers in each group, then you subgroup and see, and it's important. I'll show an example tomorrow where I have taken children with cerebral palsy with low IQ, with normal IQ, and compared the cognition with the DTI, how they fare differently, you know, how their, you know, how the IQ affects the dactylography and the functionality. So it is always good to have subgroups if possible, the numbers allow to take. Don't take numbers if they are giving you a false impression. They should be statistically viable, you know, in terms of power analysis, in terms of justification of numbers you're taking. Then you should do it. Why not? Because that gives you a better understanding of the whole analysis which you're doing. So Subgrouping is always good as long as you have the numbers.
I can make a suggestion.
Sure.
Maybe we can have a project in which not just we work with those templates to take an individual's data and then put it on that template and match, but then imbue the template with the other things. So like all these connectivities. So I mean we make it a little functional brain, let us say. So we have the associated images which will make the corresponding volume, and then we have the tracks, we have the areas, we know a little bit about their functionality. So whatever is known, we code all that and make it a kind of a functional software.
Mm-hmm.
And then whatever you expect in psychology, so this area will be activated, why it will be activated, isn't it? Whatever you are doing, what is the purpose of that? How does it interact with the psychology of the person? So all these things are put as associated properties. I mean, whatever is known, so those things are known. So then I know that if I activate over here, then it has a relation with these things, so much is normal.
Mm-hmm.
And then is there some abnormal reaction, or there is something extra, and then what is normal?
Mm-hmm.
How much should be normal correlation, etc. So all this could be done by making a model, and then just like you are having simulators.
Mm-hmm.
So here then for emotions, what are the kind of actions which will take place? We can code those, and then along. So now this becomes our setup instead of just the template.
No, I agree. See, to begin with, you start somewhere, but you can create your own template. Number one, like I give an example, MLI template. But MLI is basically, if you have a larger normal. First of all, what is normal? That question is always now, after having the last couple of years seen that. I am not sure we are all normals. We are abnormal in some way or other. To define normality, if it is within the like 66% or like outlier 33%, I don't know how to, and which way, which respect we are 66%, which way we are 33%, we don't know. So that's another issue which I always debate in my mind, that why I am normal and why this guy is not normal. You know, that's a question which you, the same two individuals, you can question yourself, you know. And you must be seeing that during a discussion, while you have a heated discussion with your friend or your colleague, oh, this guy is not normal, there's something wrong with him, you know. So to define normality is a big issue by itself, you know. So I don't understand, you know, how to define normality. Is a biochemical normality or a functional normality or a morphological normality? So I really don't understand this question. It's a big question. Can you debate it at any length of time, you know, without any problem? But what you have a suggestion is a good suggestion, but it needs a lot of effort and dedicated groups who work on this, and definitely come out with it. I always believe, you know, we published a paper, our daughter is part of the paper, where we showed that the Indian brain development, children, the brain development in the child in utero, it follows different pattern than what Americans have described. We published that based on the histology and DTA, and when I showed that to the DBT, they were amazed. They said, nobody has done this. See, we do not know, we always compare with the Western world. Our gold standard is the West, not us. I think you and myself discussed number of times regarding the same paradigm or a psychological cognitive paradigm used in Eastern UP, the same paradigm used in Odisha, the same badge of meaning. And you cannot generalize the paradigm used in X part of the country, even the country, and the Y part of the country, because their local dialects, the way they perceive things is different. In Delhi it is different, in Gurgaon it is different, I have seen now, and in the Lucknow it was different, in Kanpur it was different. So one has to create, I think we had discussed at length a number of times how to create our own paradigms based on the local language, the local understanding, the local dialects. What is common to a people, to a person in this part of the world, maybe the bird is a sparrow, for the some the bird is a parrot, for some the bird is something else, or you know what I mean. So this is important. So you have to generate your paradigm, the local dialect, the local need, the local understanding of the subject. So, and but we always, I have never seen a guy who is talking about the Indian paradigm or the paradigm in our context, paradigm in relation to the X community or the Y community, because even the community wise is a difference. Even in the same local dialect, the practice from the Muslim, the practice from the Christian, the Muslim, the Sikhs are different. They perceive different the same thing, you know. So we have never designed the ethnic difference in the, you know, in the perception of the same thing. And we try to put in everything in one way or the other, you know. That's another big issue which I think which needs to be addressed. And it is not a, it's not a simple issue. It needs a lot of effort. And I think me and Dr. Brajbhushan discussed a number of times this issue, and we said, oh, let us put somebody and let somebody does it. That's all. We never beyond, went beyond that, I think. So it's a good thing to understand, but it's not easy to do it.
Actually, it gets related to the phenomenon of an operator and a machine.
Mm-hmm.
The same machine can be used differently by two operators. And the two operators behave differently if the machine is different. Our psychology changes when we switch over from, say, tablet to desktop. And if I use a tablet, and a kid uses a tablet, the use is different. So here, I mean, the brain, the structure is similar. What differences are made by, you know, how a person uses it? How do I use my brain? So then, what are the effects of the, say, there is a patient or there is a person. You are imaging it, the psychology of the person, I mean the earlier psychology, how does that react with the current things, whatever you are trying to do?
Mm-hmm.
So this also comes into question.
In fact, I can see a beauty in what you are saying. Most of the construct in psychology, in terms of quantification, majority of them are always, the concerned psychologists who try to put it on a scale. So you have a variable degree. Now if I look at MRI data, I find that say area X of the brain is right now lit, and therefore I consider that this is the area responsible for this task. Now when you have a variable intensity, is it that the same area is involved, or is it that some corresponding area also gets involved? Most of our psychological processes cannot be completely compartmentally removed from associated functions. Like say if I am experiencing an emotion, and if you are say looking at the intensity of my emotion by default will have some cognitive appraisal of the experience, the feedback that I get. No? I am happy, I express my happiness, and if my surrounding is not appreciating my reflection of happiness, I will calm down. So there would be no emotion itself, for example, even though I am mapping the intensity, will be associated with several other functions. So if I put it into the model that you are suggesting, then perhaps some great things might come out. Okay, let's say which MRI research as of now shows that this area, so there you find that it's not only this, but other associated functions, or variable intensity and more than the area that was usually anticipated.
The one function relates to so many areas of the brain. I will show you tomorrow, you have not seen that. Bashwati has done the FSL analysis, where we have tried to see which areas of the brain are showing a relation, correlation with some of the cognitive functions. You know. And you can see that actually. You can actually see this is the structures, you, that's automatic. It's a correlation. And then you do an ROI analysis, you find there's a correlation for the same region. So that we are going, that I think some, you are one of the co-authors, by the way. We submitted the abstract to the RSNA. And we didn't tell you that we have done all this.
So here there is one question. What about fMRI with humans and fMRI with animals?
Oh, there are plenty of papers on that.
So because their psychology hopefully is not that complicated.
No, people are doing like this, all these various models of the animal where they do different kind of cognition tests, you know, and they do it on MRI. There are a number of papers available.
So does it
awake and sleep and all kind of things, they do all kind of things. And
see, I think certain things, say for example, motor activity, for example.
Motor, no issue.
Or sleep, eating behavior,
yeah.
Okay, sex behavior, okay, many behaviors now which are common.
Repetitiveness.
Repetitiveness. So many behavior, these behavior you can still make a comparison. But higher cognitive functions.
No, वो तो higher तो फिर पता नहीं उनका क्या है.
Sir, I also have a related question. I try to put it as best as possible. My question is about dynamic systems. For example, the usual paradigm that we develop for measuring, say, memory. We are measuring some point of the memory. For example, we are asking the person to recall a word, and when he recalls the word, maybe you can measure that entire process. But what about the entire dynamics from the time that he's asked to recall it till the time that he actually recalls it? That actually can be an entire dynamic system. So
that you can't assess at this point in time because we don't have temporality. We don't look at the temporality. We are looking at few seconds. It doesn't take a few seconds to think. What you just now told me doesn't take a few seconds to think. So that is something which the resolution, the temporality, both are lacking. I mean, this is just a very crude tool to begin with, I will say that. Mm-hmm. And you feel something, you feel happy, something is happening. What is the real truth? We'll know maybe in the next our next avatar or something. You know, I will say that. And it is my and Dr. Rathore, you towards the other end of the story. So we may gradually get into that. Kind of mode. But certainly what you said is absolutely correct. I mean, I'm with you on this, that what we are seeing is not really real truth. But something is being said, something is being done, and you feel happy about what is, you can understand today, and tomorrow the same thing becomes, you know, like, you know, something which you should go further on. And that's how people make interest in science, do new things, develop new things, you know.